The meeting is still in progress. Order, please.
16年稅務修訂.
We now resume the second reading debate of the Linen Revenue Amendment Bill. Mr. Andrew Leung, Chairman of the Bills Committee on the above bill, will address the Council on the Committee's report. Mr. Leung. As Chairman of the Bills Committee on Inland Revenue Amendment Bill 2016, I hereby submit the BC report to the Council and would highlight the Committee's work. The objective of the bill is to amend the Inland Revenue Ordinance to provide a legal framework for implementing automatic exchange of financial account information in tax matters, or AEOI, so that Hong Kong can comply with the relevant international standards and enhance tax transparency and tackle cross-border tax evasion. In the proposed AOEI regime, Hong Kong's financial institutions must carry out due diligence procedures to identify financial accounts of overseas tax residents in Hong Kong and pass on the relevant information to the Inland Revenue Department. The IRD would exchange the account information with tax authorities in relevant tax jurisdictions. Since not all members of the Global Forum on Transparency in Exchange for Information for Tax Purposes have committed to implementing AEOI and Hong Kong adopts a territorial-based tax regime instead of a tax on a worldwide basis, some members are concerned whether Hong Kong must implement AEOI and the possible impacts to Hong Kong if we do not pursue this new standard. The administration said that of the 100 members of Global Forum, 97 tax jurisdictions committed to an AEOI regime. And among Hong Kong's top 20 trade partners, more than half have committed to AEOI. As a member of the Global Forum, Hong Kong has considered global trends, and in order to maintain our competitive edge, there's a need to implement AEOI. The administration also pointed out that the Global Forum will conduct a peer review on members regarding AEOI implementation from 2017 onwards. Hong Kong must pass the peer review in order to not be labeled an uncooperative tax jurisdiction and be subjected to unilateral sanctions. Although Hong Kong adopts a territorial-based tax regime, implementing AEOI is still beneficial, since this would allow the IRD to gain comprehensive financial information of Hong Kong taxpayers to assess and recover tax in default from some Hong Kong taxpayers. The Bills Committee is aware that if the bill is enacted in mid-2016, Hong Kong, the administration will identify potential AEOI candidates and aim to conclude CAA negotiations with the first batch of AEOI partners by the end of 2016. This is to pave the way for FIs to start conducting due diligence procedures in respect of their financial accounts in 2017. The first exchanges of information with Hong Kong's AEOI partners are scheduled for September 2018. The Bills Committee urged the administration to explain to the public the AEOI arrangements and tax residency rules so that the public would not fall into a legal trap by misfiling information to FIs. The administration said that generally speaking, to determine whether a person is a tax resident of a jurisdiction, the physical presence or stay in a place would be considered. For instance, a stay of more than 183 days within a tax year. If the account belongs to a company, then the place of incorporation or where the central management and control of the entity lies would decide its tax residence. The administration stressed that account holders are obliged to carry out all practicable measures to ensure the correct tax residence information filed. The administration pointed out that the public can refer to the OECD portal on tax residency rules. The IRD would also communicate with the financial institutions to promote the AEOI regime. The Bills Committee is aware of how FIs can exercise due diligence to identify the tax residences of account holders. especially when the relevant account holders refuse to provide information, or if the accounts pertain to a trust or estate with multiple beneficiaries. The administration said that the bill has stipulated the due diligence and reporting duties and procedures of FIs. For new accounts, the FIs must require self-certification from account holders to determine the tax residency of the account holder. For a trust, the trustee must include information of the controlling person, including the beneficiary, when submitting self-certification to FIs. After all reasonable due diligence, if the FIs still cannot obtain self-certification from the account holder or other documents to determine the tax residency of some account holders, the FIs should treat such accounts as undocumented accounts and report to the IRD. The Bill's committee is aware that the bill includes sanction provisions on AEOI and the relevant parties involved in AEOI, including FIs, FI staff and service providers, as well as account holders. On proposed offenses for account holders related to misleading, false or incorrect self-certification, some members are concerned that their account holder might not understand the legal liabilities involved in filing info to financial institutions, and they might not understand the legal concept of tax residence and might inadvertently be caught. Some members suggested that in case of reasonable suspicion, the IRD should first seek confirmation from the account holders involved on the self-certification information. And the IRD should only take enforcement actions if that person provides misleading, false or incorrect information. The administration explained that even if the account holder submits misleading, false or incorrect information in making self-certification, the administration cannot establish that that person commits an offense based on the self-certification provided. The account holder only commits an offense if he or she is proved to know that the information is misleading, false, or incorrect. If necessary, the IRD would actively contact the account holder to review the information contained in self-certification. The account holder can provide further information and explanation to the IRD. If the IRD has reasonable cause to suspect that a person has committed an offense, the IRD would remind that person of the right to keep silent during investigation. The administration stressed that after the IRD opens an investigation, the account holder should be allowed to confirm or correct the information. And if that person corrects correct information when confirming the IRD, it would not be an offense, and the proposed sanction would become futile, and arrange the effective implementation of AEOI. The Bills Committee also inquired whether the IRD would exercise its information gathering powers under the existing provisions of IRO Section 80 to require an account holder suspected of making false self-certification to provide information, and whether that person can exercise his or her right to silence, which would undermine the person's privilege against self-incrimination. The administration explained that when making an investigation, the IRD does not have to rely on statutory powers in Section 80, but would refer to the rules and directions for the questioning of suspects and the taking of statements. The relevant persons would not contravene IRD or IRO Section 80 because of keeping silence. To protect the interests of the account holder, the committee suggests the administration to come up with measures to remind account holders to be careful when making self-certification and remind them of the legal liabilities. The committee also studied whether a mechanism has to be introduced to inform the account holders of information submitted by the FIs to the IRD, or allow the account holders to inspect the information submitted by advice to the IRD or those submitted by the IRD to overseas tax authorities so that the account holder would have the opportunity to correct the information. The administration pointed out that they have reminded the relevant advice to take appropriate measures, for instance, updating the personal information collection statement of advice to inform the account holders that the information collected might be used for AEOI purposes, and the account holder must take all practicable steps to ensure that the personal information or particulars are correct. Moreover, the advice in the self-certification forms would introduce words of reminder or warning to the account holder of the legal liabilities when making self-certification. The administration also pointed out that according to the PDPO, the account holder has the right to review and update their personal information with the advice. Members of the committee are aware that the bills prescribe the due diligence and reporting duties of the FIs when hiring service providers under the AEOI regime. Some members feel that the proposed sanctions on the service providers are unfair because the providers might only be acting upon instructions from the FIs if the provider cannot fulfill the relevant duties. They should only constitute contractual matters between the FIs and service providers, and civil liability should ensue. Some members suggested the authorities to, or the administration, to take out the sanctions on service providers. Some members are also concerned that if such sanctions are retained, it would the FIs would encounter great difficulties in hiring service providers in the future to fulfill AOEI responsibilities. The administration said that the service providers hired by FIs must take up responsibilities under the bill, and the relevant work is important in the implementation of AEOI obligations by Hong Kong, and that such sanctions on service providers are necessary to avoid contraventions which might affect AEOI. And the administration stressed that for FIs who have employed service providers, they must carry out due diligence and reporting duties, and such duties would not be exempted. They also pointed out that according to the proposed sanctions, the service providers would only be held liable if they fail to comply without reasonable excuse. If the service provider files misleading, false, or incorrect information, they must be proved to be doing it in a knowingly or reckless manner before prosecutions can be made. Moreover, the service provider providing misleading, false, or inaccurate information in a material particular may be subject to imprisonment only if it does so with an intent to defraud. The administration considers that the proposed offense provisions have struck a balance between facilitating the practical operation of RFIs and ensuring effective implementation of AEOI arrangement. The Bills Committee inquired how the administration can protect the confidentiality of the tax information exchange under AEOI. The administration explained that since AEOI will be implemented with CDTA and TIEA partners under the respective CDTA or TIEA, the safeguards for EOI will be equally applicable to information exchange under the AEOI mode. If an AEOI partner does not comply with the relevant regulations, the administration can suspend the EOI arrangement or terminate the CAA. Neither the Bills Committee nor administration would move amendments to the bill. Chairman, here are my personal views on the bill. and exchange of information and text matters are a global trend, and the objective of the bill is to establish a legal framework for an AEOI regime. Going forward, the SAR government would sign agreements with other jurisdictions under this framework, bilateral agreements instead of multilateral agreements would be signed, and that's as such the BPA and the public would support the bill. Tax account information are crucial information, and we want to be careful with how we deal with the information, and the administration confirmed that only the name, address, date of birth would be exchanged. The relevant TIN or account balance would be excluded, and the administration has said it, has made it clear, and the FEs covered would only cover certain insurance companies, custodian institutions, investment entities, and so on, as well as companies with headquarters in Hong Kong and branches of overseas companies in Hong Kong. And for government institutions, non-declarable institutions, and life insurance accounts would be excluded. The bill also provides that and MPF, provident funds, inactive accounts, etc. would be excluded because of lower risk of tax evasion. And this would save troubles for the public and as well as the administrative workload of the financial institutions. Well, in the meeting in the on the 2nd of February, the cost would not be transferred to the consumer, as Ms. Ng Liang Xing suggested. When scrutinizing the bill, members were concerned whether the relevant information can be filed correctly, whether, for instance, whether a person is a tax resident of another jurisdiction, and the TIN. A lot of Hong Kong people have moved abroad or have studied overseas. But the administration cannot rely on the relevant people to determine whether they are tax residents. A lot of people have lived or worked overseas, and they do not know whether they are a tax resident overseas. And the administration told us that to determine whether a person is a tax resident in a jurisdiction, the physical presence and stay at that place would be determined. For example, whether it exceeds 183 days in a tax year. And citizenship or nationality would not be the sole factors. We hope that the administration can educate the public properly and clearly of the tax residency requirements so that the public would know how they can file the self-certification form. The self-certification form would be passed on from the banks to the account holders. So it's easy to make mistakes in filling forms. So when the FIs pass on this form to the account holders, they must explain the purpose of the form clearly so that the account holders can fill in the right information. There were concerns of criminal liability in case of misfiling of information, and I share the same concern. The administration explained that any mistakes in self-certification would only be a liability under certain conditions. For example, the filing of misleading or incorrect information, they must be done in a knowing or reckless fashion. So self-certification would not make an offense in itself. So they must be proved to do so in a knowing or reckless manner, and I accept this explanation. So perhaps the secretary can reiterate that point. I support the resumption of the second reading of the bill. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. President. In recent years, for the international community to avoid tax evasion and to prevent the loss of tax revenue, taxation transparency has been given more significance, and therefore there has been enhancement in the exchange of financial account information in tax matters. Well, for the OECD, it has come up with the common reporting standard. Governments have been asked to do the following, that is to get detailed account information from their financial institutions, and then on a yearly basis, there should be automatic exchange of financial account information in relation to the counterpart jurisdictions. And then we have also got the Global Forum on Transparency and Exchange of Information for Tax Purposes. All members have been invited to give a commitment. Hong Kong is a member of this Global Forum, so Hong Kong has the obligation to commit itself so as to avoid being labeled as a tax avoidance or tax evasion haven or an uncooperative taxation jurisdiction. And 97 tax jurisdictions have already given the commitment. Moreover, among the 20 important trading partners of Hong Kong, more than half of them have indicated their support, that is, they support the AEOI. Moreover, it will help to improve our business environment if we align our practices with the international practices, and this will enhance Hong Kong's competitiveness and our status as an international financial center. Therefore, Hong Kong should support the new standards for exchange of financial account information in tax matters so as to tie in with the global trend of combating tax evasion. I think we should cooperate with the international community in such matters so that we can safeguard the legitimate interests of the taxpayers, and we can also regulate the conduct of cross-boundary taxpayers. Therefore, the DAB is in support of the Inland Revenue Amendment Bill 2016 so as to improve our taxation system so that we can meet the standards under AEOI. As to the details of the bill, I think it is complicated. Citizens find it difficult to understand. I think the DAB would like to see more public education so that members of the public as well as reporting financial institutions will understand the AUOI better. According to the requirements, reporting FIs have to carry out due diligence checking so as to make sure that the reportable accounts will be reported by the relevant account holders. The FIs have to collect the information. For the reporting FIs, they have to submit the forms to the IRD. In the form submitted, the name, address, domicile, tax information, or taxation in identification number, country of birth, etc., have to be given in the form. I think sometimes a citizen may not be too sure about his tax residence, in particular those who have emigrated overseas and have returned back to Hong Kong, and also they were previous. Some people were previously not tax residents of Hong Kong. Some residents are worried about their tax residence status. Therefore, we need to enhance appropriate education, both for the citizens as well as the reporting FIs, so that they know about the operation of such a system and also the criteria for defining the tax resident status. I understand that there are due diligence procedures for the reporting FIs. I'm concerned as to whether they would add to the compliance costs on the part of the RFIs. For the compliance costs to be shifted to a third party is also a concern on my part. I hope the administration will take a progressive approach in implementing the AUOI. There will be a code of practice to be issued for the industry. I think there should be more communication with the RFIs, in particular the small and medium RFIs, note to their concerns and the difficulties. I think we should simplify the procedures as much as possible. I understand that the administration did tell the Bills Committee that if the RFI has already followed the requirements under the Anti-Money Laundering and Counter-Terrorist Financing Ordinance and has carried out due diligence checking, then the RFIs would be allowed to use the information collected from the Anti-Money Laundering Ordinance so that the account holder will not be asked to provide a separate set of information. In this way, the RFI's burden will be eased, and I hope that the authority will come up with clear guidelines to cover this matter so that the industry can effectively discharge its duties. I also support the fact that lower-risk RFIs and low-risk accounts will be exempted. I think in this way, it means that we can reduce the impact on normal business operations. Mr. President, as a result of the AUOI, there will be the use or submission of personal financial information. So I think we have to make sure that there will be strict confidentiality regarding such information. And we have to make sure that the AUOI, our partner jurisdictions under the AUOI will handle the data in a proper fashion so as to safeguard the interests of the account holders. FIs should also take measures to inform the account holders as to the purposes of the collection of information so as to avoid causing harm to the account holders. Recently, we understand that we have got more cases of internet banking being hacked into. The Hong Kong MA disclosed that last month, four banks reported that almost 28 accounts have been subject to unauthorized security or stock transactions, and it involved 45.9 million dollars. Fortunately, money hasn't been unlawfully transferred, and then it is said that a lot of personal information of Hong Kong citizens are available and have been offered by criminals, but such information has been obtained in an unauthorized manner. We need to be on the alert. I think it is difficult to prevent such technology crime. Therefore, we need to upgrade our security system and we have to handle such information carefully. In relation to the service providers for the RFIs, their employees, as well as the account holders, there are sanction clauses in the bill. Some members of the BC have said that when it comes to the self-certification by the account holders, we understand that the criteria is that when the information given is misleading, false, or inaccurate, then there will be criminal sanction. Some members pointed out that it is not necessary because it may be a mistake only. The administration has said that this is in line with foreign practice and also the threshold is high. It is only after the IRD has carried out an investigation and has proved that it is a matter of doing it knowingly or recklessly, resulting in misleading, false, or inaccurate information in the self-certification. Otherwise, there won't be any conviction of any criminal offences. Moreover, the account holders will have a chance to defend himself, and he has the chance and he has the right to remain silent. Some members have said that the bill has said that if the service provider hasn't got a reasonable defense and yet has failed to discharge the duty under the AEOI, it will be an offense. It is said that such a provision is unfair to the service provider because the service provider may merely be following the instruction of the FI. Moreover, it is something between the two parties. It is a matter of their own arrangements in their cooperation. At most, only civil liabilities should be involved. The administration has explained that when a service provider carries out the work, they are sort of doing a very important task. It is only when they haven't got reasonable defense for failure to carry out their work, or only when they knowingly or recklessly provide misleading, false, or inaccurate information to the IRD, then it will be a criminal offense, or maybe it is out of the motive to defraud, and then it will become an offense. The DAB is of the view that the administration's explanation means that there has been a balance between the two areas of concern. On the one hand, we can facilitate AOI. On the other hand, we can protect the interests of the parties involved. It is not a matter of unreasonable sanction on the part of the offender. As to James Toh's CSA, that is, when an account holder carries out self-certification, when the account holder knowingly or recklessly provides misleading, false, or inaccurate information in material items, Mr. James Toh would like to strike out the words knowingly or recklessly, and to strike out the words misleading and inaccurate, so only the description of false is being retained. In this way, this is raising the threshold of prosecution. And the account holder would be given a second chance. That is, when the assessor carries out an investigation, the account holder should be given a second chance to submit further information for the purpose of self-certification. It is only when the same information is given and then there will be a prosecution. The DAB objects to this amendment. The DAB cannot agree to strike out the words misleading and inaccurate. This is because we talk about misleading, false, or inaccurate information, and such a drafting style has been adopted from both domestic and overseas legislation. We have got it under in the Securities and Futures Ordinance. If we take out the two words, it means that we are being relaxed, and there may be the holding back of the truth, and there will be problems. In the course of it, the investigator will ask for further information, and if the account holder has been found to have done it knowingly or recklessly in giving the misleading, false, or inaccurate information, then the account holder will be prosecuted. If it is a matter of inadvertent mistake, it is quite unlikely to have happened. So I support the bill and I oppose the CSAs from Mr. James To.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy. I speak in support to the resumption of the second reading for the Inland Revenue Amendment Bill 2016. As members have said, the objective of the bill is to implement international standards on automatic exchange of information by the OECD. And the purpose of the exchange is to enhance tax transparency and tackle cross-border tax avoidance between jurisdictions. In September 2014, Hong Kong has committed to the Global Forum on Transparency in Exchange of Information for Tax Purposes to implement the new standard with its partners. The Hong Kong SAR has also committed that the exchange will be implemented in September 2018. So it's an appropriate time to pass the bill because the SAR government can make use of 2017 and the first half of 2018 to make changes on the on the CDTA and the relevant provisions. And during this consultation, a lot of SMEs and individuals are concerned at the impacts of this ordinance on privacy or financial information. But I have to point out that if we fail to conduct exchange according to the ALEI regime of the OECD, then we would face grave consequences. In 2008, in February, we can look at the OECD's definition of a tax haven. The OECD has three different components to this definition. One, if a jurisdiction has only nominal taxes and the primary purpose of the jurisdiction is to appeal to overseas companies to be incorporated in a jurisdiction to evade taxes, then this jurisdiction can be labeled a tax haven. For instance, some jurisdictions have no profit taxes at all, and let's say if you only pay $1,000, which is a nominal tax, and if a jurisdiction attracts the incorporation of nominal companies in order to evade taxes in other countries, then if a jurisdiction takes part in such activities, it can be labeled a tax haven. And the second definition, if a jurisdiction has laws in place to protect personal assets, well, Switzerland was an example. If the police wants to obtain information or financial account information, Swiss banks could reject it. Of course, Switzerland had changed the laws. And under the banking ordinance in Hong Kong, a lot of exemptions are given so that law enforcement agencies can obtain financial information of certain persons on court approval. And the third component to the definition of OECD that if there is a lack of tax transparency so that overseas jurisdictions cannot gain access to the tax information, then that jurisdiction can be labeled a tax haven as well. Without an AEOI regime, Hong Kong might very well be labeled a tax haven or an uncooperative tax jurisdiction. What are the downsides? In 2009, at the G20 forum or summit, Hong Kong was once listed on the grey list as a possible uncooperative tax jurisdiction. At that time, the then president Hu Jintao was engaged in some negotiations, and as such, Hong Kong was removed from the grey list in 2015. Hong Kong was labeled a tax haven by some EU countries. Now, it was a surprise because according to the definition of a tax haven, if at least 10 EU countries label Hong Kong as a tax haven, then Hong Kong would be on that list. Now, this is not a very scientific standard. And due to this label, global companies have hesitated in incorporating in Hong Kong or working with Hong Kong companies, and as such, I support the passage of the bill. However, in enforcing the ordinance, I hope the government pays attention to certain areas. In the scrutiny of the bill, some deputations, especially trustees or trustee institutions, they are concerned that the information would be abused by unscrupulous parties, including thefts of identity and possible blackmailing threats, etc. Apart from legal protection, before the proper implementation of EUI in 2018, and in the IRD guidelines, the administration should tell the public of how the administration can ensure security in the transmission of information from FIs to the IRD, and what security measures are in place. I understand that encryption is a standard measure, but this is inadequate. The Director of Inland Revenue told me that the information, the transmission is one way, and I don't understand because there would be an eventual exchange of information. So if there's only if the information is only inbound, and whether there's a single channel in sharing the information outwards, if the outgoing tax authority use the information beyond tax matters. For example, if the information is passed on to the local police for criminal investigations, would or can the SAR government do anything? What can they do to stop these overseas jurisdictions from doing so? Is it enough to suspend the AOEI arrangement? That's our concern. And the second point, I hope the administration can be careful in identifying the first batch of AEOI partners in 2018. Of course, there are some objective considerations. Now, one factor to consider might be that these jurisdictions or countries must have signed tax or AUI agreements with Hong Kong. Now, this is obvious to save time. And the second condition is that these countries or jurisdictions should be members of the OECD. And the third condition, there should be a substantial number of tax residents in Hong Kong. If there are very few tax residents in Hong Kong, it might be a waste of time. And this is against the principles of AEOI. And the fourth condition, Hong Kong should have substantial trading activities or commercial activities with that country. Now, finally, after you identify a partner, if, let's say, if there are a lot of tax residents in Hong Kong, let's say 400,000 to 500,000 tax residents, now by September 2018, can AUI be really implemented? This is a very real possibility you have to consider. As other members suggested, in terms of provisions of the bill, and as I suggested in the Bills Committee, sanctions on, I talked about sanctions on service providers, and I asked the administration why those sanctions are in place. Now, in the common reporting standards, such sanctions do not exist. I understand that local FIs are subject to substantial pressure in operation and costs, and as such, service providers are required to carry out due diligence duties. Now, I looked at the administration's explanation, and under Section 80D on prosecutions to service providers, and in the provision of misleading, false, or inaccurate information in a knowingly or recklessly fashion. And we can look at some concepts in a common law, for example, without reasonable excuse, recklessly or knowingly. Now, in similar sanctions, similar words are used. So the professionals can look at the cases under common law and the interpretations of those terms. I hope the IRD can provide operational guidelines on these terms and how they would enforce the regulations. I look for a clearer explanation for account holders, FIs, or service providers. There should be clearer guidelines. Now, I looked at the criminal liabilities of third-party service providers. The fines are at Tier 3. Now, having considered the matter, I find the provisions acceptable. If the service provider has a fraudulent intention, imprisonment sentences are possible for offenses in a knowing or reckless manner. A a level 3 fine would be possible. Now, when we look at bigger issues, in recent years, the council has debated different various tax-related ordinances. In the last 4 years, there are 93 clauses in the bill, and 14 clauses are related to tax, of 14 of the bill. And I understand that the workload is heavy. Now, if the AEOI provisions are enforced, a lot of bilateral tax agreements and exchange agreements must be renegotiated or amended. I hope the administration has enough resources and manpower to carry out such negotiations. And in terms of enforcement, I hope the ILD is given enough manpower to execute the regime. We are not just talking about executing the agreement. Very often, the overseas jurisdictions request information from us instead of the other way around. Ms. Ng Lang Seng, please.
Mr. Deputy, the banking industry in general agrees that enhancing taxation transparency is the global trend. So in adopting the Common Reporting Standard, CRS, as the basis for exchange of financial account information in tax matters, that's important too. That will help to maintain Hong Kong's position as an international financial center. The banking industry believes that the basis of the bill is pragmatic, it is effective, and it is operable, so it can be supported. On the execution of the legislation and its enforcement of this legislation, I would like to make some suggestions for the government's consideration. First, for relevant government departments, before the actual implementation of the bill, for taxpayers and financial institutions, there should be sufficient publicity and education for them. That will help to reduce the administrative cost for the relevant institutions in future, and it will also help to reduce negative impact. First point, that was. The second point, in the Inland Revenue Department, at the initial stage, there should be a telephone hotline. So for taxpayers, and when they have questions, then there's a channel for them to make inquiries and seek assistance. Third point, I agree to what's said in the Bills Committee report. In the initial stage of the implementation of the automatic exchange of financial account information in tax matters, AEIO, the government should be more flexible in dealing with non-compliance by FIs. Because this has been the practice for the implementation of new legislation, usually there is a so-called grace period. And so during the teasing stage, the administration should deal with any problems that arise. This new legislation will lead to a lot of new scenarios, so I hope that there will be a suitable grace period, and I hope there will be flexibility in implementing legislation. This is to ensure a smooth transition for all parties involved. Fourth point, if the government could come up with detailed interpretation and practice notes that would help the industry and the FIs in helping them with compliance. Finally, some members asked whether the it's about some members' amendment, whether there's a charging effect and the arrangement in terms of the relevant documents. Now, I have studied the issue carefully. I would suggest that the government should give an open explanation, because in future there is a need to refer to such documents. I speak in support of the bill. Thank you.
Mr. Sin Chung Kai, Mr. Deputy, as stated in the report, the purpose of the bill is to provide a legislative framework for the implementation of the AEIO. In Hong Kong, we have the territorially based tax regime. In other words, never have we been necessitated to introduce AEIO. However, the OECD has come up with the common reporting standards, and therefore Hong Kong has committed to implement the AEOI automatic exchange of financial account information in tax matters. To become a member of the Richmond's Club, we have to do it. As we have said many times, this is more for others' sake than for our own sake. But then since we want to be a gentleman in tax too, so we have to do this. While we are doing it, we have to bear in mind certain concerns. For the AOI, it means that this will enhance tax transparency among the jurisdictions, but then we have to be careful about the penalties. Say, for example, self-certification made by account holders. Should misleading, false or inaccurate information be submitted therein, there will be a penalty, and then there would be offenses for service providers for reporting FIs. First of all, let me talk about the simple principles involved. Generally speaking, when citizens submit information to the government, if it is a matter of a deliberate attempt to provide misleading information, etc., it is reasonable and right to attract a criminal liability. In particular, when it is a matter of a statutory requirement. When I go to a bank to open an account, it's not that I deliberately deceive the bank, but sometimes things may have expired and we don't care at all. We might have dozens or even 100 bank accounts. Some of them may be dormant accounts. If the government is to penalize us for inaccurate information therein, it will become a problem. And therefore, at the Bills Committee meetings, we did address such points. In a moment, James Toh will be moving amendments in this regard. We do believe that, of course, for the broad principle, for the fundamental principles and the broad framework, we subscribe to the philosophy. In this case, of course, we'll be providing information to others rather than get information from others. We haven't got any global taxation arrangements. For the Panama case, we have become sort of the attention of the world. Of course, we have to align our practice with the international standards. And come next week, we have the Financial Institutions Resolution Bill. We have to support the new international requirements. However, while we take care of the need to meet international standards, we don't want the Hong Kong citizens to be caught unnecessarily and innocently. Under the bill, when you submit information for the sake of self-certification, and in material items, if you submit misleading, false or inaccurate information, when convicted, you will be you will have to pay a level 3 fine. Of course, when we give information to an FI, we may not be aware that there will be a liability. Therefore, James Toh would like to take away the reference to misleading and inaccurate. Inaccurate. It's easy to be found to have given inaccurate information. Nowadays, we no longer see bank statements in paper. We only get the electronic copies. From time to time, we may move house, and then we have to prove our address. If we haven't updated our address with the bank, it will become a problem, but it is common. We used to receive bank statements in paper, and when we didn't, then we know there is a problem. There isn't a quorum. Members, please take your seat. As the bell to summon members has been rung for 15 minutes, we did not have a quorum. I now adjourn the meeting.